Hi, and welcome to Telepathic TV. This is television that you watch with your third eye, and I'm Richard Johnston.
And I'm Mary Phelan, and our program is about raising our consciousness. And tonight we're going to pose the question of what happens between lives. We hear a lot about this life, past lives, future lives, and even parallel lives, but we don't hear a lot about what actually happens to us when we cross over between that time and when we are born anew, if you believe in past lives or in future lives.
Well, yes, quite naturally, it's the sequence until you graduate the wheel of karma, as they say, which is where you figure all this out. And figuring it all out is another program completely. So what happens when you are between the lives is a long and complex thing. It's going to depend upon the individual, but you go and you meet the cast of characters that have made up this life. Only you get to meet them as a soul, and then you can begin to figure out why these people were put on your path, and seriously figure it out without all the down here stuff in the way.
Mm-hmm. Well, I've had the benefit of speaking to, and I know a lot of people may not believe in this, and that's okay. Everybody's entitled to their beliefs. But I have spoken with thousands, let's say, of people after they have crossed over.
You're very good at that.
In readings for people where they connect. And I've gotten a pretty interesting picture of the mapping of where we go, what we do after we pass. I know you take people between lives on a journey so they can remember their in-between lives and what they do there. And you're right, it's as unique as each individual is. Our beliefs create our reality. It also creates our afterlife reality for a time. And the beliefs soon for some, it takes a while for others to fade. I have talked with people, spirits, aspects of people, whatever we want to call people's soul, that still carry for just a short time some of the beliefs that they held while in physical. And I still believe that the more you can deal with your life here, the easier your transition into the afterlife will be.
Absolutely.
That's what the Toltecs called the benefit of recapitulation, or soul retrieval. You go back and deal with the things so that you don't have to have your life flash before your eyes. You know how they used to do that on all the Gilligan shows and everything?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my life's passing before my eyes. Well, I think what essentially that means is if we deal with our life as it comes up, meaning dealing with the emotions, dealing with the issues that come up, that when you cross over, you're not going to spend that time dealing with it. You'll just spring consciously into this afterlife. And I've had a lot of experiences of my own, and I know you've had a lot that you have seen with other people going on journeys there.
Oh, yeah, it's an absolutely fascinating process. Some years ago, I came to the conclusion that what we're calling senility is actually that process beginning. In other words, we're kind of kept alive longer than we might have without offending anyone. And then as we become senile, that's the beginning of the transition where you are recapitulating, as you just said, and starting to piece together what this life really was.
Yeah. Yeah, I came to that conclusion a long time ago as well.
Yeah.
That's what my theory of Alzheimer's was, was kind of reviewing things. And I found that the longer it takes for one to pass is often a direct relationship to how afraid they are to pass.
Yeah, to the resistance they mount.
Yeah.
I think you had said that. I mean, about Alzheimer's or whatever that was.
Oh no, I think
senility.
You observed it too. That's
yeah,
fine.
Yeah, I think we both did.
No, I think we are in agreement there because it really is a time of recapitulation where you review your life, and either you do it consciously or unconsciously. And I'm sure there are many, many different reasons.
But it is the processing that you do at a certain place while you're on the other side. Mm-hmm. Only it's not, there's no negative connotation to it whatsoever. It's done as groups. You're actually with the people that had the experience. You get to see it from different points of view, their points of view. Because the same event has as many points of view as there are observers of the event, each one being valid. That's the interesting thing about television, in that if you watch a particular show, the brain doesn't know particularly that you're watching a show. You're just having an experience. Yeah, and some of them we could do without and in a big
That's
way.
For sure.
Yeah, but so you get to, we agree to have a lot of experiences in a given lifetime, and you can have them by watching them on TV, interestingly enough. And we've seen television, not our program, of course, but we've seen television have profound effect, you know, as you become very empathetic towards whatever the character is in the movie, or if someone in the movie ceases their incarnation, you kind of go through that same grieving process, you know, so to speak. But it's safe because it's over there and it's on TV. Mm-hmm. It's not like you're, so in a way it's a sort of practice mode for us. And in that way, kindred to the between life experience, because the conversations and the planning that goes on, we've leaped ahead. But the group that you're going to incarnate with are all going to choose different roles and incarnate, each playing a different role from the life before, so that everybody gets a place in every slot over and over and over again till you catch on to what's really, really going on there.
Well, I think, yeah, that's really true. I have a memory of my own, which, you know, I've said on the show before, so I'm sure a lot of people have heard it, but I had a memory, a very clear memory, of my past lives and in-between lives and the state I was, you know, expanded into during that time, ever since I can remember. And that memory was of sitting on this being's lap, so to speak. I wasn't in physical form, obviously, but I just was in this large expanded state. I felt bigger than solar system kind of feel. And there was this map book, this huge map book being opened. And I remember just making all these selections. That part was very fuzzy or less focused, but I could still remember it clearly, not like a fuzzy memory, but. And it kept drilling down, so to speak, until I saw the solar system, and I remember picking the Earth. And on the Earth, I put my finger, or I remember my attention being drawn right to the DC area. And so I knew I was going to come there. Mm-hmm. And there was another awareness, I'm not sure if it was in that moment or whatever, but it was almost like being pulled down into a situation. I do have memories of my birth and 4 months old that can be substantiated and things like that. And I just remember when I was 4 years old, 3 and a half or so, I was sitting in a sandbox and I started forgetting why I came here. I was really in a panic as I realized I was forgetting. I knew why I picked my hair color, my birth order, all these things. It was very specific and it felt very natural and real. And I think we all have that same experience, only I remember the forgetting. And that allowed me to keep tapped into that. But when I talk to people that have passed, often I'll work with someone through mediumship and visit, you know, or have the session about someone, or someone will come through. And then they may come back sometime later and that person will come through again. And I can always see a progression with that person in what they've resolved, and there's always a great understanding the moment someone crosses over, passes on, whatever we want to say. Mm-hmm. There's always a greater understanding of their whole life, their awareness, and their relationships with the people, and their feelings really do ascend to a higher level right then. But the more you go, they get higher and higher, and they even appear to me as higher and higher up in the room. Mm-hmm. And that tells
me. Oh, that's interesting.
It tells me, just as a symbolic language, where they are at. And it always brings a great understanding of what's going on in life. And they often will have a wise understanding of circumstances in the lives that they shared with the person I'm sitting with mm-hmm. to share. So there is a great, great education mm-hmm. and awareness or epiphany time between lives that I've noticed.
Yeah. Well, you have a very clear perception of things. I've never really met anyone else that has that level of understanding.
Well, sure, there are plenty, but I do have a lot of years of experience with this, and it's fascinating to me. I would really love to write out a map of what I perceive that place to be.
Oh, yeah.
And I know you're probably putting together a lot of pieces of that puzzle, doing that work with people.
Yeah, there's quite a bit to it. You reminded me of a story where there was two brothers. One was age 3, the other was age 5. And the 5-year-old wanted to be alone with the younger brother. And the parents went, you know, what's with that? And so the parents agreed to it, and they had the baby monitor on. And the older child asked the younger child, "What's God like? I'm already beginning to forget," just what you said a little while mm-hmm. ago.
Oh, I remember that story.
Right, right. Yeah. That really went around, mm-hmm. and it's very true. And at age 65 now, I think I am, I wouldn't mind knowing a little bit more about what God is like in, you know, in filling hearts and things like that. But interesting that so these spaces between the lives are like 100% of everything is education. You can find no exception to that anywhere, which is so ironic because people think they're done being educated when they get out of school, right? Mm. Yeah, I mean, interesting planet, fairly corrupt in its own way. But this idea of finding, everything is education, therefore there is no such thing as a test. It's only more education. The word test is a kind of bitter piece of language for us because we, you know, pass, fail, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. But something we could step aside, it's just going to be more education no matter what you do.
Wow. Well, you know, I think there's something I was going to say about what were you just saying about?
There's no such thing as a test. It was a trick
prior
played.
Prior to that.
The 5-year-old and the 3-year-old.
Yeah.
Everything is education. There are no exceptions. Mm-hmm. No matter what it is, it's education.
Yeah. Yeah, it was something about, I just wrote down the buzzwords because I was interested in what you were saying, so I kind of lost my thread there. But I think that when I was younger, I would have these experiences, especially from age 18 through 35. I had these divinely directed experiences. One in particular, I was going to sleep one night. This was about 1981 or 82, and this being took me, psychic, like my spirit, into this big room. And it was almost like a boardroom table, and there were these beings in these big white robes, and they were just they had the energy of largeness. It's not like I had anything to compare them to see if they were big or small. Like one time I was very young, and I was taken to this planet with a mushroom growing out of it, and I was asking, is that a really big mushroom or a really tiny planet? Because I was taken out of the realm of relativity.
Uh-huh.
Do you see? And I was trying to orient myself. Well, same with this. I didn't know if these beings were large or what, and I sat down at the opposite end of the head person at the table. I was sitting there, and I was kind of scared because I had a lot of out of body that were very tangible, more real than physical reality, and I didn't know if I was in trouble or whatever. And so I sat there and they were reviewing a lot of my choices that I had made and things like that. And I brought back somewhere I have the writing from that whole experience. And what I realized is many of my experiences up until a certain period in my life were directed by the divine. They were divinely orchestrated. I've had those experiences since I was a child, and I even have things I've written when I was very young about some mm-hmm. of these experiences. Mm-hmm. And then there came a time where I started directing them myself instead of them being directed by the divine, where I just was there, I was falling asleep, and all of a sudden I was on this journey, much like dreams are. Mm-hmm. And then there comes a time when you become a conscious lucid dreamer, where you start directing your dreams. And I really think that when you leave it up to the divine to direct, you can go places you've never dreamed of. If you direct them, it's limited to what you can imagine, you know, or that.
Oh, very profound.
That kind of realm. Mm-hmm. And I realize that that's a lot about our spirituality now. That we are taking, I am creator of my reality. And I know mm-hmm. we teach that. We've taught that for 16 years, okay? Mm-hmm. Every week for 16 years, those concepts. But I'm starting to think maybe we ought to give up some of the control in our spiritual journeying. And I'm not talking about surrendering and taking no responsibility for self, but letting spirit direct your teachings, because those were very powerful things I learned.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And I agree with you that that's, you know, because no one answer is always correct. Mm-hmm. No two answers are always correct either.
Sure they are.
So the movement forward, I quite agree. So we had decided that today would be a day of miracles when we, you know, came conscious again and remembered to make such a thing happen. And I've been watching things in a certain way. And I've got to agree, it's having a very positive effect on things. And I think that was one of the miracles there, is to give up the rigidity. Anything that's rigid is not going to last. Anything that's rigid must, by its own nature, dissolve. Mm-hmm. And so,
a lot can be done. It's a state of receptivity and allowing, mm-hmm. and trust that there is an aspect of us and a force that is larger. Florence Shin talks about all suffering is really. She doesn't say it like this, but this is a paraphrase by me. That everything we go through that we deem painful is because we are believing in two powers instead mm-hmm. of one power.
Right.
And it's like what we say, believing in good and evil and right and wrong, as opposed to just one thing, mm-hmm. the yin-yang complete, you know.
Well, there's a lot less resistance when there's one thing. Once there's two, there has to be resistance. Mm-hmm. One has to resist the other. But if it's all one thing, there's no resistance because there's nothing to resist against.
Yeah.
Yeah. The havoc ensues around resistance every time. Resistance is always because of an attachment to an outcome. And yet resistance is our great friend because traction is a form of resistance. Mm-hmm. And without it, you couldn't walk. So it's a real bind resistance. It's necessary to live in a 3D body. It's necessary. It's an essential, resistance is an essential part of free will.
Hmm.
You know, in order to choose to do this, I have to resist every other thing that could happen. So you are constantly in a state of resistance, yet resistance seems to provide us with irretractable attachment. You know, it's mm-hmm. a very interesting thing.
Well, what about resistance as a state of mind as opposed to a state of physics?
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps the resistance in physics is actually a cooperation of two forces to create a larger goal,
which we resist. Yeah.
And then the resistance in the state of mind is an obstinance of two forces not working together for a larger goal.
It's very obstinate, observationist.
Obstinate of me?
Yeah, obstinate. Instead of observation, obstinate, ervation.
Mm-hmm.
There you go.
Yeah.
I got the brain to work. I'm so proud.
Yay.
That gives
good
me something
brain,
to do.
Good brain.
Yeah.
Good
that's,
brain.
That's another very...
Well, I'll just tell that real quick because
yeah,
I think
please.
It's a good thing. I was going somewhere in which I really required my camera. That was one of the reasons I was going. And I almost left without my camera, and it would have been a long drive to come back. And I remembered before I left the house, as I was walking out the door, and I ran up the stairs to get it, and I was going, oh, good brain, you remembered, such a good brain. And I felt my head, even when I said it now, get very excited, like it just was alive. And mm-hmm. I realized how much we're, oh man, I forgot that. Oh geez, how smart was that? We're constantly disparaging our brain. So
yeah.
Everybody say now, good brain, good brain.
Brain.
I'm so
good
proud
brain.
Of you.
Yeah,
you're
yeah.
such a good brain.
Yeah.
It I feels good. It's high, it gets you higher than any drug.
Yeah, I remember one time we had a contractor in the house to install some plumbing or other, and he goes, look at this box. I look at the box, and you know, the part number's on it, but it's a different part in the box. He goes, well, I got to go. So I didn't, you know, I decided to go with him to the local hardware store. And we get in his truck, and the entire dashboard is covered with Post-its. Okay? It's like snowing Post-its in this guy's truck. And I go, what's with that? And he goes, oh, these are things I have to do. And I go, well, you know, you are setting yourself up for catastrophic memory failure here. Because you've externalized.
Well,
your,
now he is, yeah. for
but,
sure.
Yeah, but that becomes the externalization of what would be internal. But
well, I see your point.
Yeah.
I see your point. But you know, on the other, by the same token, I mm-hmm. get your point. I'm not evaluating that at all, because we have to trust our brain and say good mm-hmm. brain, which is your point. I think that's well taken. I find that I have so many things going on at the same time, at any given time, throughout my whole life, mm-hmm. that if I write it down, it frees up RAM in my head, and then I can process it easier. So sometimes writing it down clears out random access memory so that you can just process your reality. When you have a lot of things, mm-hmm. then you're not using up all your space in your brain. Eggs, bread, milk, butter. Eggs, bread, milk, butter, when you're trying to remember it in your head as you're walking to the store.
Or driving, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you read my mind yet again. I was, when you said RAM, I went, oh, random access. I knew M was memory. Random acquisition, I think my brain was thinking at the time. It doesn't matter, but yeah, no, there's a definite telepathic, and the name of the show, right?
Yeah.
Communication, and this goes on with the audience. And I'd heard someone ask a question earlier on, which I've forgotten already, in the audience, which I meant to mention, but it slipped by, about, doesn't matter. But a lot of, physically call in, by the way, as you know, this is a live call-in show. And if you have a question or a comment, you'd be very welcome to give us a call, and we can answer your question or comment on your comment. But do realize you have the faculty. Otherwise, we will kind of pick it up. But and it does kind of steer the steer the show. But you're very welcome to give us a call so that we can get a clear message back to you.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, you do know who you are. At least in theory.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know, some of the other stories of in-between lives, I remember early on when I was doing readings for someone, mm-hmm. a young girl came and her father appeared. And at first, and this is a good lesson, something I teach in psychic development, which mm-hmm. Later in a month, like later in the summer, early fall, I'm going to be teaching the psychic development series parts 1, 2, 3, 4.
Oh my God.
So people, if you're interested, I haven't done that in quite some time,
yeah.
So if you're interested. Anyway, one of the things that we all know in intuition is to trust and validate everything you receive
mm-hmm.
and deliver it in its pure, pristine impression form rather than in its interpretation, because it's really up to the other person to interpret it. And so I almost didn't say it, but thankfully I did. I saw, she was wanting to connect with her father, and I saw a man in a top coat I'm a top hat and top coat, sort of like from the 1800s. So I said, well, that's what I see. And that was very meaningful to her because her father wore that as a costume in certain things that he did, and he loved that outfit, and he wore it all the time. I spent, this was probably 15 years ago, I spent a good portion of time in meditation where he came and taught me a lot about the overview of the afterlife and the mapping after mm-hmm. you depart your incarnation. And of course, it's very unique and different to everyone, and we get, we free ourselves from our own prisons and progress through that at our own pace and for our own purpose. But mm-hmm. he showed me this place that we all kind of find ourselves in, and it's not really a location as much as a state mm-hmm. that we're in. And once we realize what happened and we go through our initial emotion, you know, there are a lot of choices to step forward and to connect with that larger part of us that knows where we're headed next.
Yeah, and there are even greater parts than us, at mm-hmm. least I've noticed, in an unbelievably loving and kind way, wish to very gently guide, mm-hmm. But are a very positive influence.
Yeah.
One of the things we could say is that the group, we go through in groups. You know, if you know someone that's one of your group members, if it's somebody who's not you might see them on a subway, but there'd be no eye contact or, you know, stuff like that. There are a lot of groups here that don't, you know, it's not, in a way, we're all one group, mm-hmm. okay, without a doubt. But specific soul groups go through together where they incarnate in the same times, playing an assortment of roles. The same group that was a platoon could come back as a factory where the whoever was in charge of the platoon is the CEO, and all the way right down to the production line, mm-hmm. you know. And only one time you'll be in one place, another time you'll be in another place, even though the play that the group puts on once they've decided the play, and once everybody's decided their role, and once everybody's done rehearsing, then the group parachutes back into 3D, we don't leave all at once, though, you know, so mm-hmm. it takes a while for the group to recollect.
Yeah, and sometimes we actually do. I remember reading this mm-hmm. from, I think, Edgar Cayce, and as well as Seth talked about that there are groups that die for certain causes that will come, whether that's the Holocaust or 9/11 or all the Iraqis that passed in mm-hmm. the wartime. Or Iranians in the Iraq-Irani war, or the Russians, or whatever grouping, mm-hmm. that they come to create social change, social awareness by dying en masse. So there mm-hmm. are those that are born in groups and everything. Mm-hmm. And that's a very, very interesting thing, because that's not something that in the work that I have done, that I found a lot of that, but I certainly believe that, and I'm aware that there are recurring things. And something else I noticed, that there can be a location. There are certain spots in the world or in this country or whatever that may collect certain groups of souls that tend to live a number of different lifetimes as different races of people. Mm-hmm. It might be, you know, but on that same location, that same spot. And the way it was shown to me in a meditation is if you take flat pieces of paper and they're, or layers of some sort, and they're on top of each other, and every once in a while there'll be a straw that drops down and connects all these, and it changes. And sometimes it's over a location, sometimes it has to do with a people. It harmonizes all the time with different things. But that's where there is a bleed through or a crossover. And I think it's over these points that we perceive a lot of orbs, or that we have communication, or it's what people say, oh, I'm picking up a lot of energies here. It's where these realities may be over blending, let's mm-hmm. say.
Blending's an interesting concept. I know we were talking earlier in the restaurant that One of the pictures in the introduction to our program was taken on the beach by a fire that was made of set down triangles and then put wood, three boards that fit together as a triangle.
A stack of three boards, so it was like a...
Yeah, so it was a trinity in and of itself, and then we did sacred songs and so forth while we were walking around this fire. And
we did a whole new moon ceremony there.
Yeah.
And the picture that the orb at the show opening is from was one that I took when we were done with the ceremony. And that fire you guys built was amazing. If you picture like a log cabin, how it's interlaced, but it was a triangle interlaced with boards. You put the fire in, and then when the fire was burned out, it burned the boards around it, and it was quite a spectacular scene.
Yeah.
But it was right after that event, and I think you were talking to everybody there, and they were so vivid, and I clipped out just a few of the orbs, and Miguel,
who did the introduction for us,
revamp on that, added those.
Yeah, but orbs are in and of itself a program. You know quite a bit about orbs.
Remember the one where you were leading the ceremony? I think it was in 2007, the big concordance.
Yeah.
And we had a big event at our place, and there was a circle, and you were leading. I think I had those on the old website, so they're probably still out there, where you were doing this, and one was going right into the back of your heart chakra.
Oh, yeah.
We have some really interesting pictures.
Orbs are a fascinating item. They're not exactly between lives item, because that's a whole different concept, but I've always held the idea that orbs are points of consciousness that are completely free, and not just a point of consciousness, a consciousness that is fascinated by we humans, evidently. And if people are interested in something, orbs gather around it. And that particular night, that particular new moon ceremony, there was an enormous amount of energy. And also the air was particularly wet because it was right next to the ocean. And it was not exactly stormy. We had thought it might rain us out earlier in the day, but it didn't. But it was very, very moist air, and I think they
were. Yeah, they usually do appear in moist air.
Yeah,
lots of things travel on that, and you know, I'm very left brain as well as right brain. You know, I was in IT for a number of years. I'm very analytical, but I'm also very right brain. And I thought at first orbs were just some kind of camera feature. And I thought, well, I'm going to seek out to prove this. And sometimes there would be things I thought, wow, and then they turned out to be something different. And other times I thought, oh, it's just a feature on the film, but it really wasn't. And one particular class in my psychic development, part four, we do spirit photography amongst many other things. And two people were we went outside into the woods as it was dusk, and all assortments of cameras. We went through a process to charge our cameras to receive this. So people's cameras that had not been taking orbs all of a sudden started getting orbs amongst other features, psychic phenomenon on the camera. But two people took a picture of the same tree standing like a triangle, and they both got the exact same orb. And I have found, I've gotten them so specifically clear, like if you look at the opening roll-in, the eye of it, I've had it telescope and look around as if it is an eye. And they are perception points.
Absolutely. And they seem to have an origin that we're unfamiliar with, because I believe they're more or less equally throughout the entire universe observing and what... So they have
that
to.
That could still be us from in between lives as well. There's no limit to what that is.
Yeah,
I haven't
that's
formulated
true.
An opinion, because I feel like there's still so much to be seen. But I do know that when people are meditating or attempting to figure out a problem, like I took one series of pictures where the orb was here. Someone was trying to figure out how to operate a camera a number of years ago. And the second picture was here, the third, and then it was right here. And the minute I took that picture, he figured it out, like right when the orb got right here.
Huh.
So I don't know. My mind is very open. It could be so many different things. But now let me ask you this. I know that you have taken people into in-between lives. Is there anything common that you have noticed that people share that they had a realization? I know there's usually a life review where they come to some higher conclusions about their life, like perspectives and things like that.
What is common is everyone is greeted. You don't necessarily know the person that greets you. When I was physically between lives, I was greeted by an angel that apparently practiced Sekhim, as he pulled a piece of sky made into a ball and threw it at me, hit me in the chest, and calmed me greatly. The effect, I'm sure I've explained that, maybe not. Once I was dead, no tunnel, I was just in a room with this angel, no borders on the room, just presence of the angel. And the angel was reading a book, and I began the guilty dance, and the angel closed the book. And the guilty dance is where you talk about what it is you could have done in your life. All the things I could have done, all the talent I had. And he just balled together a piece of sky, Sekhim, blue, and pitches it at me. And for years I played the game. Most people would guess it hit me in the third eye, but finally people now commonly realize it hit in the heart. And it calmed me down, and I stopped the guilty dance, and then he began to explain what was going on, you know, once I was calm enough to hear it. And that's a particular between lives, which I've told so many times. But generally, you're going to be greeted and then led to your theater group, the group of people that you incarnate with. And then it's like coming home. It's your family all over again. There's nobody, pardon me, there's nobody absent. They're all there. Even if they're still incarnate and you aren't, and it's a very heartwarming thing to have happen. And then there's a bunch of games played as a general rule, like children playing games where there's nothing but fun. You know, it's just all fun. There was, it'll just depend. And then there's revelations revealing. And so the boy that put your pigtails in the ink, that's back a few hundred years, so it's safe to speak, you know, won't reference anyone in this time slot. Well, you see why he did it. It's because he has absolutely no skills whatsoever in communication with a woman. None. That was the only thing he could do is, oh, look, you have ponytails I don't hear. I put it in ink. Aren't you proud of me? And the little girl is going, oh, God, you know, what is this? I have to get away from this guy immediately. And it's just talking about.
Is that where the poor communication between the male and the female began?
That was it.
The inkwell.
That was the exact moment where all communication broke down between the genders. And from then on, it was just who knows what. Yeah. And once in a while, it ends well. Mm-hmm. Apparently, it takes a great deal of aptitude and fortitude and fivitude.
You know, just on that subject, I know this isn't about between lives, but really a commitment and of any sort, whether it's between a man and a woman or between two friends or an employer and employee, is about a decision to do that. If you say, I'm going to be there at 5 o'clock, you say, I make the decision to be there. You have to make all commitments for you, and you have to uphold your commitments based on you, not because somebody's going to get mad at you or somebody's going to fire you if you're late. You have to do it for you.
Yeah,
honestly,
exactly.
We become free from enslavement the minute we do things for ourselves, and a lot of that has to do with having your own code, your code of ethics, and you just stick to it, and then nobody else, there's no middleman in there. I worked at a company that very often would not live up to their word. They would say, yes, you'll get a raise in February, and you know, all this stuff. So I hung a sign that said a person's word is the currency of their soul. Are you passing out bad checks? I decided early on I was gonna do the best I could to live up to my word. Do I do it all the time? No, because sometimes I overextend myself and I may not make it on that date, but I never take it off my list until I get to it at one point. And I've learned a lot not to put things on my list that I'm pretty sure I can't fulfill either through time or whatever. It's a learning process, but I think that really it's not about obeying the laws of God or whatever. It's about obeying your own laws. Mm-hmm. And what are those laws? And are they laws and rules that you can feel comfortable with, and can you uphold them?
Yeah, that's a very clear way to put it. And I don't know that it's been that well explained. Here in the history of the human race.
But then you don't resent anybody. Then you don't resist anybody. Then no one is making you do anything. It's all your decision to do it within yourself. That's when you're free. You don't do your homework because your mother's making you. You do your homework because in your code is, I would like to do the best I can and take advantage of getting an education or whatever that is. Then you're always doing everything for you. Nobody, you don't have to engage with anyone else in that process.
Well, you have a very clear story to tell that illustrates that point perfectly about the, I believe it was in France, a farmer had his farm taken over by the Nazi occupation.
This was from Man's Search for Meaning by Viktor Frankl.
Oh, okay.
And forgive me, it really was like 1980 that I read it, or early 80s. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I'm sure I'm butchering the story, but it had something to do with that, and I'm pretty sure it was from that book. The book, of course, is extremely powerful. I highly recommend reading it. I remember one of the greatest things I ever got from books back then was something out of that, when the conclusion was that life really is, the way to get through life and to cope is God is playing solitaire with himself or herself. And that's what we're always doing in all these exchanges. So no one really loses and no one really wins. It's just a game with self. But ultimately, back to the story you're talking about, there was a farmer and the Nazis occupied and took them prisoner. I'm not sure if that was a Jewish family or what, but they kept them around as servants, and they had to go sleep in their own barn, and the Nazis occupied their home, took all of their things. And after the war or whatever, someone asked him, how on earth did you cope with that? He said, I had two choices. I could see them as taking these things from me, or they were my honored guests that I would be very grateful to serve them.
There it is.
And so that was a great catalyst in them surviving mentally and physically, I think, and psychologically and emotionally.
And it is, as you were saying, God playing solitaire with himself.
Yeah.
Only you happen to be involved.
Yeah.
Yeah, but that is actually one of the more brilliant things I've ever heard.
Well, one of the ways I coped, I've had some extreme times in my life, as I'm sure we all have, but I coped in that, what if I made this, what if I chose this? Like, what if this traffic jam was something I chose? What if this job and this situation for some higher purpose? Like, what if this was really what I want? I remember driving around the Beltway in traffic many years ago saying, I came up with this chant, if you can't have what you want, try wanting what you have. If you can't have what you want, try wanting what you have. And it triggered me into, one morning I woke up and just pretended that, like that past life or that parallel life of mine, what if this was exactly what I asked for? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Gratitude is what you seek. It's not the thing, it's the thing that brings gratitude. That's the feeling you're seeking. You can do it right now.
Yeah. And I believe it's time for our duck to wing his way on the stage. And here's Mike, who's, there we go, all right. Let loose the duck.
Born free
as a duck can be.
I started too low. Remember that your timing is always perfect. Relax and enjoy the ride.
Ah, I got two. All right, so just one
and
second.
And these are Mary's magical message cards. Yeah. It's a deck, my most recent deck. There's 97 cards in the deck.
And they're all beautiful. Remember, you can choose how you feel and how you react to situations in your life. You're the master of yourself. Second one is trust your heart's knowing right now. Seek the deep counsel of your own experience. Very good. Yeah, that's an excellent deck.
Ducky.
Bye-bye, duck. Thank you, duck.
Well, they're based on my scrolls that I give people.
Yeah, which are an interesting concept. Mm-hmm. I wonder if anyone in the audience has a scroll. They might want to call in and read the scroll. Just an interesting thought. Wouldn't that be an excellent feedback?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That would.
So.
Well, you know, this whole idea of being between lives, these places where we figure things out, where we figure out what we've learned, we process, we absorb that wisdom from that life and make decisions on what we wish to do next. All of that is interpreted through our linear view of things, but it really is a time of vast expansion.
Oh,
it's
yeah.
like we come down here and gather experiences, and that's where we plant them and they flower.
And digest.
And we
and
inhale
become.
The beautiful
yeah.
aroma.
And then the wisdom. Mm-hmm. So it's, by the way, this is the time where you may call in to ask a question or get a reading. So please do so if you are interested.
Well, you can call in all during the show to ask a question.
Yeah. And this
and
is.
You're certainly free to ask a question now too, but this would be the time for the readings, which we don't have to do.
Speaking of which, there's the experience, writing it to memory, the knowledge of it, the wisdom, which yields the evolution, which is a mnemonic of five, and that's the system, and that you may pass before the evolution arrives, theoretically not, but it does arrive, even if you put in the work, and then pass before you get the evolution up online.
Yeah.
So.
Well, that's really the story of every emotional processing, too.
Mm-hmm.
One of the, it's interesting that you would come up with that five-step thing, because one of the ways I describe emotional healing is that usually we have an experience, it comes in, we process it, it gets converted to wisdom, and then we change or we grow.
Oh, good.
And that when we have an event that's too big, we have the experience, it gets lodged and never gets processed.
I see.
So we can't get the wisdom from it, so we create another event. Can't get the wisdom from it, we create another and another, and by this time we're getting very triggered by things that we don't understand, and that whole circuit is laden with these unprocessed experiences, and that's one of the things that I assist people with through tapping and other methods is to find those circuits and to clear them. That's very simplistically put, but converting then the experience to wisdom, which creates a cognitive shift, which is the manifestation of change.
Well, how about
a reading?
Let me see. What is my, if it's for me, since there's no one's calling in. Okay, so what is my next evolutionary step?
Okay.
What is my next growth, however we put that?
All right. Okay.
Oh.
So the first card, I guess we haven't clued people in as to what we're doing. The first card is new vision. This person is walking around, you can barely see it, kind of walking on hands and knees, nose to the grindstone, survival, and then they stand up and they see this world all around them, and then they notice the infinite sky that just goes on and on forever.
Oh, the stars.
And so it's, you're noticing your connection to a larger vastness, and just when you said the word stars, I think this really is about getting your galactic history, which, you know,
Let's
I've been
that.
A champion
yes.
of all of your things that
you
do. I really feel like I'm the nagging
light
fire under your feet for you to produce.
We will produce.
I lit that fire for the hidden language codes because I really believe in what you have to say.
Thank you.
And I think that the galactic history is
a great one to be next. We'll put that out.
Also, the dream. This card is interesting. It shows a woman dreaming of her life will be happy when Prince Charming comes or when this comes. And I think we do have these dreams that we think that these things that looked fulfilling in our youth are still out there as these white whales that we must capture and conquer. But when we get them, we realize it's a dream of the past and that I was like, like Cinderella here, just sitting there dreaming of something instead of going out there and seeing what's alive in her life today.
Mm-hmm.
And so perhaps it's saying maybe some old dreams, revive them, look at them, set them down.
Oh, that's really
and
good.
Create the new reality and leave some of the dreams, like crystallize them or let them go. And then beyond illusion, so you've got a lot of this new stuff coming in. Beyond illusion is the mind, the known mind, the things that we know are really the illusion. The things that we don't know or we haven't really pulled down is the reality. And so whatever we think we know locks us in a box. So
yeah.
Maybe re-look at some of the things known.
Very well said.
Now pull a card for your
chakra affirmation. And we could do that very same thing for you, perhaps, just a thought.
Okay.
All right, and so my chakra affirmation is third eye chakra. I see into the hall of records of all that has been, is, or will be. That'll keep me busy.
Yeah, and if people would like a reading, the number is 571-749-1166. And so I'll say that again if you would like to write that down. 571-749-1166.
We have a caller. We can do that later for you if you mm-hmm. wish. Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
Hey, it's Lina.
Lina, well, welcome.
I went down and got my skull, two of my skulls that I have on my kitchen.
All right.
Oh, thank you.
And one of them is observe your life from the state of allowing. This state of non-resistance will bring you many insights.
Excellent.
That's what you were talking about.
Wonderful.
And the second one is, your body is being upgraded to a new vibrational frequency. Be patient as more energy comes to you.
Oh, wonderful. Well,
right.
Thank you.
And
yeah.
Both of them are. It's funny, the days that I choose to see them again are just the days that I need to hear the message on them.
Oh,
that's what's so brilliant about your scrolls. Yeah, Lina, good job on displaying them that way.
Yeah, thank you.
I need things in front of my nose.
That's a good place for them to be, I tell you.
It is. Thank you, guys.
Oh, thank you. Thank
bye-bye.
You. Bye-bye.
Well, bye-bye.
It's like if they're in front of your nose, you always have to admit that you knows them.
Nothing like nosing around.
Like Jimmy Durante. Yes.
And yes, did you wish to?
4 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I believe this is only the second time that we have. Oh, we do have a call. Okay.
Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
Hi. Good evening. It's Marilyn. How are you guys doing?
Hey, great, Marilyn.
Good.
How are you?
Yeah.
Long time no see. Doing
yes.
good. Summer seems to be flying by.
Yes,
oh, yeah.
Absolutely. Good to hear from you.
Yes. I'm enjoying the show. You guys look great, and I wondered if I could get a reading.
Sure. Thank you for calling in, and thank you for not making this the second or third time ever that we didn't have a reading call in. So, but Lina was...
Lina called
okay.
in. Yeah.
Well, the first card is... talking about source. When we forget our source, we find ourselves scrambling for resources. And one of the things that this is saying about you is you really are a powerful manifester. And I know this to be true about you just from my knowing of your energy. And so don't forget that, because whatever you are looking for right now, you can have. And sometimes we forget that because the world tries to push our buttons and it causes us to tense up and forget that, and we enter into a debate in our mind like these clouds fighting represented. But sometimes it's saying that even if we're in that debate with ourselves or someone else, there's a time to just set the armor down and be in that state of receptivity to bring that allowing back into your life. And this is going to help you to clear some of the self-judgment and everything. I just feel like there was a cloud, a block, or a stagnancy, I don't know if that's a word, that is getting ready to clear, like if you had a clog in a pipe and it just moved forward and things started flowing.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's like you're going to be hearing from people, things are going to be connecting, and almost like a job situation too.
Excellent.
So thank you. Thank you
yeah,
very
excellent.
Much. And did you want to pull a chakra affirmation real
quick?
Oh,
yeah, if you're still there.
I know we're down to 2 minutes, so.
Okay. Pardon me. And this is the crown chakra. I am always aware of my higher self's direction and insight.
Beautiful.
Excellent, yeah. So we've been doing this work for...
I guess it's too late. Okay.
No, we can do that.
So we've been... I was going to hold the card up.
Doing this work much longer than the show has been in existence. You've had who knows how many years. I don't even know when I began. I think I was very young. Before I was shot, I was teaching palmistry. Went all the way back. I remember going to... anyhow, and you've had an enormous history.
I really have had these experiences since I was a child.
I did
readings with playing cards and mm-hmm. various things, elementary school, things
yeah.
like that. I asked for the I Ching when I was 8 years old. I asked mm-hmm. for my birthday, mm-hmm. and I got it. Somewhere I still have that yellowed old copy.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't figure out how to do yarrow sticks at the time.
Oh, well, they were
I was only eight.
Yeah. Yeah, they've since simplified the techniques.
Yeah, the coins.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do know how to do that.
And all of this, the between the lives,
yeah.
all of these are permutations.
Yeah,
the work you do now is...
I know we're getting the signal here that we're getting low,
yeah.
but check out the website, telepathictv.com. You can mm-hmm. look at archive shows. You can mm-hmm. get us on iTunes, on podcasting, Telepathic mm-hmm. TV, the audio.
Yeah.
Yeah. of the show, and yeah. there are meditations, there's mm-hmm. Neville's art, his copper, my decks you can play and give yourself readings,
mm-hmm.
telepathictv.com.
Yeah, and the older you are at this, the better you are at it.
Yeah.
Thank you.